All right, so you've seen part one, you've seen part two, and now you're here for part three to talk about the hierarchy of positions and go through Patrick's comment and figure out which Ashigurami should be at the top of the pyramid. So part of Patrick's question says, is one more dominant or is it preference-based? And I think this kind of sums up the general theme of this video, so I wanted to talk about this first. Just as some people prefer the rear naked choke in MMA, while others prefer not to put their back on the ground and just smash people. They're both very good strategies that work at the highest level, it's just one person prefers to do one over the other. The same thing goes for leg locks. One person could love the 50-50 position and build a whole brand based off of 50-50, while others could be very successful at avoiding 50-50 and using outside ashi instead. So all of this is basically to say that this video is my opinion based on my preferences, and your preferences could very well be different. But what I think is more important is to understand the strengths and weaknesses of the positions, as well as the transitions that lead to your favorite positions. So if I really like outside ashi, and I know that it offers a great deal of back exposure and counter leg lock exposure to my opponent, it might not be smart to just shoot right to outside ashi. Instead, I can start in a rimi ashi, work my way to inside ashi, and then ultimately find my way to my favorite position of outside ashi to get the break. Or if I really like inside Sankaku, a good way to get there is to go to inside ashi first, force them to roll, and spin into inside Sankaku. So using these ashigaramis in combination, I think, is the true apex of the pyramid, but nonetheless, it's fun to talk about which positions we prefer over others, so let's get into addressing the rest of Patrick's comment. So he says, I don't think anyone would argue outside Sankaku is more dominant position than standard ashi. So since we haven't covered outside Sankaku yet, first we're going to talk about what that is. From inside Sankaku, if we take our inside leg and put it up towards our opponent's belly button, we then switch to a position we call crisscross ashi. Then if we take our outside leg and throw it all the way across to our opponent's far hip, we call that outside Sankaku. And I would 100% agree with Patrick here and say that outside Sankaku is a much more controlling, much stronger finishing position than the standard arimi ashigurami. But things start to get a little more interesting when we start to compare outside Sankaku to inside Sankaku. And again, this is a big preference-based thing, and Lachlan Giles is the one who I originally heard of outside Sankaku from, and I don't study him too much. So I might be a bit biased here, but for me, outside Sankaku gives our opponent the ability to control our outside leg. So even if we end up getting a successful catch on our opponent's heel, they have control over our outside leg, which, like we talked about in part two, is responsible for supplying the breaking power because it gives us the ability to bring our opponent's knee inside the line of their foot. So even though we have a catch on their heel, they have control over our outside leg, which limits our breaking power and gives them a little time to slip their heel, which at the highest levels, that's all they need. Now, a time where I think outside Sankaku is very, very useful is from a 50-50 situation where you're trying to catch their heel. And as you're spinning, you're able to catch the heel, but as you go back to a front side 50-50 situation, your opponent is able to hand fight and successfully defend the position. During the transition from backside 50-50 to front side 50-50, I think is a great time to transfer to outside Sankaku. If we're able to throw our leg across to the far hip, you can see how it traps our opponent's arms and makes it impossible for them to hand fight. So I think this would be a great time to use outside Sankaku. But if I'm trying to counterattack someone from outside ashi, my preference is going to be to put them in inside Sankaku and work to get the finish, as opposed to what Lachlan did in ADCC against Gordon, as to put Gordon in outside Sankaku. And again, like we talked about in part two, don't overlook the counter leg locks from inside Sankaku. There's plenty of bad things that can happen from inside Sankaku. I'm just saying that my preference is to go to inside Sankaku over outside Sankaku. The next part of the comment asks how we compare that to something like 50-50, where it's really more about who knows the position better. And just like Patrick said, a lot of times 50-50 is a position where one person wants to be there and the other person does not. And a lot of times the person who knows more is going to start in a traditional 50-50 and start to work their bottom knee down towards the mat. And this puts them in what's known as an 80-20 situation, because you're starting to turn the odds a bit in your favor at this point. And then to really turn the odds in your favor, you can throw your outside foot on the inside to go into crisscross ashi. Or if you prefer outside Sankaku, it's a great time to make that transition as well. So like Patrick said, 50-50 is a neutral position, but it typically results in a situation where one person is on the attack trying to use these different ashigaramis to get the finish while the other person is trying to defend. But one use of 50-50 that we talked about in this video here that I think is often overlooked is that even someone who is very, very good at inside Sankaku and built their name off of using the position can use 50-50 against someone who is very good at defending inside Sankaku by building height and stacking them, which is exactly what 50-50 prevents. So again, it's about understanding the strengths and weaknesses of each ashigarami, and at the end of the day, if you can use all of them to their strengths, that's going to be the apex of the pyramid. So moving right along, how do we see backside 50-50 compared to something like double outside ashi while holding the heel? Now for me, I would need some clarification, right? Are we talking about backside 50-50 where our opponent's heel is on our bottom shoulder, or is it on our top shoulder? Because if the heel is on the top shoulder, I would take that because it's a very easy catch on our opponent's heel with a very strong finish with an inside heel hook. However, if the heel is on the bottom shoulder, I would take the outside ashi option because I'm not the most flexible person, and a lot of times when the heel is on the bottom shoulder, our opponent will backstep, which is fine. It just results in a 50-50 scenario, which honestly I would like to avoid if possible. And if we have a nice catch on our opponent's heel in outside ashi, they're not going to be taking our back or counter leg locking us. So I would take this option, especially if I'm able to start on my elbow as opposed to on my shoulder, because once you get on your shoulder, bad things start to happen. But the big issue with this strategy is that outside heel hooks are significantly weaker than inside heel hooks. After seeing Mikey Gonzalez display some beautiful outside heel hook defense against one of the best leg lockers in the world, and listening to our coach Mike Morrell break it down in this video here, I am now thinking that it's going to be very difficult to get an outside heel hook finish against the best players in the world. So while an outside heel hook might be a valid option for someone like me who is just an average grappler, if you're competing against the best people in the world that are willing to take damage to their limbs, backside 50-50 is going to be a better option. And if they're good enough to neutralize your outside heel hook threat, they're probably going to be good enough to backstep from backside 50-50. So if I was competing against someone who's very, very good, I would choose the backside 50-50 option. And if the heel is on my bottom shoulder, I'm going into this backside 50-50 expecting to go to a different position. If our opponent is nice enough to sit back into us and we can reach their far hip, we can go right into the back take. But a lot of times we're just going to have initial access to our opponent's near hip, and as we go to reach to their far hip, they can either throw their back to the mat, which will result in a leg drag scenario, or they can keep their back off the ground, which then we can work our way to the far hip and to take their back. So I'm sorry, but the answer to this question is it depends. And maybe the correct response to this question is you try the outside heel hook a few times, just as Oliver Taza did in this match. And if your opponent proves that they're game to defend your outside heel hook threat, then you can use backside 50-50 to transition to other positions like their back or a leg drag scenario, which then if you choose to go back into the legs, you're going to do so going for an inside heel hook finish. Alright, now the last part of the question talks about which hip you want to trap by gravity. And honestly, I'm not 100% sure what he means by this, but I'm going to give it a shot here. So in any leg entanglement, if you can control both of your opponent's legs, it's going to be in your benefit. And it's even better if you can control that second leg by laying on top of it. And now that frees up your second hand to help you with the submission. Typically, this type of situation stems from a position called rear Ashi, where we're sitting on our opponent with our back to them. Now, when we're in rear Ashi, we can perform an action called spinning the leg, where we'll spin around our opponent's leg and enter into inside Sankaku, where we'll then work to untie their legs and go into the finish. The second option we have is to fall the other direction and fall on top of our opponent's leg. So you can see the idea here that we're laying on top of our opponent's second leg. This puts us in outside Ashi, and in this situation we do not have a catch on our opponent's heel, so we better be ready to go into our transitions from there. So when I'm in rear Ashi, my general strategy is if I'm not able to untie their legs, then I spin the leg and go into inside Sankaku and work from there. If I'm able to untie the legs before committing down to the ground, that I think is a great time to go into this second option of falling to the hip to trap their leg and go into a variety of finishes like toe holds, knee bars, or outside heel hooks. And as we rewatch this here, you can see Craig use his foot to scoop up the leg of his opponent. And I initially thought he grabbed his own leg to tighten up the triangle, but he actually grabs his opponent's leg to tighten up the triangle. And you can just really make life suck for your opponent in this position. So hopefully that is what you were referring to, Patrick. And if not, I apologize and hope you still found the video helpful. If anyone's interested in joining the Discord, shoot me a message on Instagram and I will send you the link. If you want to support the channel through Patreon, that is much appreciated and the link is in the description below. But if not, be sure to subscribe so we can keep growing the channel, which gives me the ability to keep making videos for you all. So appreciate the support and I'll see you in the next one.